The following scene takes place in Istanbul, but it could actually happen anywhere in Turkey. On this day, Islamist business leaders gather in Congress to meet with Tayyip Erdogan. Erdogan is the prime minister. He came to power in 2003, changing the face of the country and awakening the imperial ambitions of Turkey. In just a decade, he has risen to prominence. Time magazine named Erdogan Man of the Year 2011. Before this audience of businessmen loyal to his cause, the Erdogan system or formula could be summed up in three parts. First, prayer. Prayer signals the return of Islam to the forefront of politics and public life. And for the time being, it is a tolerant Islam. Next, a tribute to Ataturk, the father of modern Turkey. He is credited for imposing a full-fledged secularism. And finally, praise for prosperity. In just 10 short years, Turkey has become a dynamic global growth engine. In 2011, economic growth in Turkey was 8.5%. This is a remarkable increase. Turkey only ranks after China in terms of country development and net growth. And speaking of growth, if there is a place in Turkey that exudes growth, Gaziantep is that shining star. And that's where we begin our journey, right at the gates of the East. Young people have it good today. We didn't have all that. They can really do whatever they want, travel, everything. We love Gaziantep and its traditions, everything about it. Turkey's number one in the world and Gaziantep's number one in Turkey. We are real fans. We live and breathe Gaziantep. It's great to live in Turkey. We really love our country. At first glance, Gaziantep does not seem like anything special. This isn't Shanghai or Dubai. And yet, with 12% growth, the city is really thriving. It's a hive of activity. One shining example, the Çağdaş family. They own the country's most famous bakery, employing 80 people. They are renowned as the country's official producer of baklava, and is the only baklava that the Turkish president serves to his visitors. This is a veritable success story. More than 120 years ago, Aji, the great-grandfather, made his first baklava. Then Aji passes on his knowledge to his grandson, Talat, who one day naturally takes the torch. I started here at the age of 7. I was just a kid when my father took me to the shop for the very first time. I've been working here for 65 years. My son is the fourth generation, and eventually my grandson will take over. The whole family is involved in the business. Amen. But until the grandson is ready to take over, it's Buran, the son, who is in charge, staying true to the spirit of family. Our passion for quality is legendary, as is our ancestral expertise. The best pistachios, the best butter, this is the secret to its unique taste that has been passed on from father to son for generations. The secret to great baklava is its thoroughness and authenticity, and that requires a lot of attention. And the company experienced a big leap forward in 2002 when the AKP, Erdogan's party, won the elections and significantly boosted growth. The VAT was lowered to 10%, exports were given a boost, and the results were impressive. 10 years later, in 2012, profits for Shogdaz rose 30%. This is the showcase of the Turkish miracle, successes like the Shogdaz number in the thousands. With 12% growth, seven times that of France, Gaziantep is one of the economic powerhouses of the country. On the outskirts of the city, four industrial parks and a huge industrial zone attracts 3,000 companies. Naxin Holding is a heavy weight of the Turkish economy. It has a large plastics factory and has soared to become the world's leader in plastic. It also has one of the largest carpet mills in Turkey. This holding is an example of what is called the Anatolian Tigers, major sectors led by a new breed of entrepreneurs who come from the heartland of Turkey and share their deep beliefs without any stigma or complex. They are pious, conservative, close to the AKP, the Islamic party in power, and proud, just like this export manager. We often speak of Anatolian Tigers, but it's not just a numbers game, nor is it just a question of production volume and the number of jobs created. We have a vision, a philosophy. We are an open door to the world. Here you have very dynamic entrepreneurs and workers. They don't wait for help from the state to develop, they take risks. Naxin exports all over the world, China, the US, Russia, India, but they have a real soft spot for the Arab Muslim world. The Middle East is obviously one of the largest markets in the world. Country development, increased purchasing power, and the explosion of mass consumption generates growth for us. And as Turkey is a Muslim country, it's also easier for us to access these markets. On Naxin's target list, there's Europe. But the European dream has gradually turned into heartache. The European mentality never changes, always practicing a policy of humiliation. At the airport, we're welcomed with dogs, we're searched, we're treated as criminals. They don't want Turkey in the European Union because we are Muslims. This is at least how it comes off to us. And it is up to Europe to change our minds. But you know, the day Europe finally decides to integrate us into the European Union, we might be the ones to say no, and then it'll be too late. Has Europe missed the boat? What is certain is that the Anatolian Tigers will not reach out to the old continent forever. Tomorrow, Europe might actually need an empowered Turkey. Two years ago, there were just butcher stalls here. Since then, the souk has been completely restored. It has returned to its glorious past when it was right along the Silk Route. Proud of their past and confident in their future, Turks like Gulsin also embody this newfound pride. Gulsin studied in Ankara, the capital, and she returned home in Gaziantep to run the family business. Gulsin is the incarnation of this new generation of young people without any stigma or complex. This is the Turkey Erdogan wants to portray, and he's riding high on the coattails of this new modern youth. When I joined the AKP, had they made a requirement to wear the veil, I would have refused, without the slightest hesitation. Tayyip Erdogan has been sincere when speaking of secularism. He did not intend to make Turkey a new Iran. But even if he had this intention, he actually could have done it without any problem. What has been AKP's recipe for success? The same here as throughout the Islamic world. Grassroots activism, social initiatives, distributing food during Ramadan. But Erdogan takes it further. He seduces Turkey's youth with a modern, triumphant image. Erdogan has taken the complex out of Islam, bringing it back into the mainstream with a modern touch. Example of this modernity, a housewife is supported by the AKP-run municipality. An idea important from Germany and funded by European money. The purpose of these centers, taking women outside of their homes and teaching them small trades. How long does it take to make one? When it comes to health issues, we are listening to the women and their problems. Every month, we offer informational sessions and gynecological consultations where we distribute condoms and other contraceptives. Whatever you do in life, do it for yourself, not for your husband. For the most part, women have been oppressed in Turkey. Thanks to these women, I realized that I was not alone. I'm thankful to them. And my husband is okay with me coming here. He understands. Before, he wouldn't even allow me to go out of the house. Now I have the right to come here. An Islamist party that promotes contraception in Gaziantep, while in Ankara, they officially ask Turkish women to have between 3 and 5 children. The AKP covers a wide scope. In Gaziantep, the AKP has held the mayorship for the past 8 years. May 1st, 2012, Labor Day. Even this holiday represents change in Turkey. Before, this event was prohibited because the government was afraid of workers and students. But now we will show them that our struggle is still alive and well. Prohibited for over 30 years, this event was reinstated 2 years ago. An indisputable democratic progress, without a doubt. And yet, the police filming the scene out in the open demonstrate that freedom is still being monitored. Even in Gaziantep, optimism should remain measured. There are 150,000 workers in Gaziantep, and out of those 150,000 workers, only a handful of diehards bothered to come out. This is the case of Yusuf. He works in a small textile factory, and there are hundreds of them in Gaziantep. After 12 hours of work per day, I walk home. It is 8 in the evening, I eat and sleep. I cannot enjoy family life. Many workers do not even have the right to come here. Look, there are almost no workers here in this area. They all stay in the industrial area. After making sure that his boss wasn't there, Yusuf invites us to join him at his place of work right after the demonstration. I earn 130 euros a week. 130 euros is not enough to pay my rent, my bills, and the education for my brothers and sisters. I've never seen a union in this sector. Workers do not even know what purpose it serves. And those who do understand, it scares them. They fear that the bosses will get rid of them. At the same workshop, a different story, that of Emre. Emre is 13 years old. Before I was going to school, but then I had to work. We needed money, and we had nothing to eat. I had to work, so I came here. Ever since we've gotten a job, my brother and I can buy whatever we need. And we paid off our debts. Who is right and who is wrong? Emre's remarks illustrate the opportunity for everyone now to work and consume, while Yusuf is telling us how the working conditions remain very harsh. As we leave Gaziantep, one thing is certain. Growth has brought Turkey back to the world stage, and now Tayyip Erdogan has some weight in the region. Now on to Kilis, the last town before the Syrian border. Thousands of Syrians who have fled recent fighting have taken refuge in Kilis. Two weeks before our visit, Assad's military fired on the camp. Shortly thereafter, Erdogan came to talk to refugees. I know the difference between the Syrian people and their government. We're with the Syrian people. We will never be with the government of Bashar al-Assad. Turkey has positioned itself as a player to be reckoned with in a region in constant movement, full of activity. In 2010, after the attack on a flotilla headed to Gaza, resulting in the death of 9 Turkish activists, Erdogan slammed Israel for being a spoiled child of the West. In 2011, the premier wholeheartedly supported the Arab Spring, lauding it as a model claimed by many from Tunis to Damascus. Kilis, in 2012, Erdogan adopts the same attitude. This time, $60 million has gone into welcoming Syrian refugees in Turkey. A bet on future course of a post-Assad Syria. Mr. Erdogan is a very good person for the cause of the Syrian people. He represents the living conscience of humanity. The world left the Syrian people to fend for themselves with a butcher. And one hand cannot applaud by itself. All of the Syrian people salute Erdogan, salute the government, and salute the Turkish people. Erdogan is a good man. He's a real gentleman. The first reactions of refugees seem to show Erdogan is on the right side of history, but his bet is still risky. A few days ago, the army of Bashar al-Assad fires at Kilis from the other side of the border. 2 Syrian refugees shot dead on Turkish soil. After our visit, The situation in Syria quickly deteriorates, and the border turns into frontline. Another frontline, but this time inside Turkey itself, where it's been like that for ages. On one side, Kurdish separatists. On the other, the Turkish army. We head to Diyarbakir, the capital of Turkey's Kurds. The Kurds number between 15 and 20 million. They also have large communities in Iran, Iraq, and Syria. Over the past 10 years, even if the situation has changed between Kurds and Turks, the scenario has remained virtually unchanged. We arrive in Diyarbakir, the capital of the region, populated mainly by Kurds, and the Iron Curtains are lowered. Diyarbakir is a ghost town. This is the cemetery where the population seems to have gotten together. A cemetery under high surveillance. The three men being buried are members of the PKK, the Kurdish guerrillas. These three militants were killed by the Turkish military in the mountains of Lice, about 40 kilometers from here. The first, son of an imam, has been part of the Mackies for the past 18 years. The other two had just turned 20. This 30-year undeclared war has claimed 40,000 victims, and yet. In 2005, Erdogan vowed to listen to the Kurds in Turkey. He promised to recognize their identity, to offer a different future for their children, and to end the misery. Seven years later, nothing has changed. The Kurdish problem remains a bleeding wound, and peace remains elusive. This morning, the families wanted to go to the mosque to pray, perform the funeral rites, and bring them here. But the prefect banned the ceremony. And so the bodies were brought directly to the cemetery. It made people very upset. They want their children respected in death. And as their fallen are not respected, they are very angry. The next day, we are at the Kurdish news agency, Dijle, where Çertaz is a reporter. I took these pictures during the funeral of these three members of the PKK. Here we see the people gathered at the cemetery, and right over there, you see warplanes flying over. These aircraft bomb PKK camps in the mountains on the other side of the border in Iraq. Çertaz is playing judge and jury, and so the Turkish government does not differentiate. All those who like him, journalists and activists publishing disturbing information, may fall within the scope of the anti-terrorist laws. The 106 journalists currently imprisoned in Turkey are mostly Kurdish journalists. In December of last year, 36 journalists of our agency, Dijle, were arrested during a police operation, and they were thrown into prison. Zubeyde is also a journalist. She works for a new Turkish news channel. This channel was created by journalists ousted from mainstream media for criticizing the policy of Mr. Erdogan. These relatives of the missing demand that their children be returned. Even if they are dead, they want to know where their bodies are. Whenever I cover a protest as a journalist, I'm always filmed by the police cameras. They can say, you were there. There is a psychological pressure. They threaten us with their looks. When something is newsworthy, I don't even hesitate. But 90% of journalists ask themselves, do I risk jail if I publish this news or that? The authorities are always trying to impose fear. And journalists are not the only ones threatened. In the name of this same anti-terrorism law, 8 deputies and 33 mayors are also behind bars. One thing has improved for minorities. They can now speak and sing in Kurdish or Armenian. Before, they risked prison. We leave Diyarbakir and the full-fledged civil war between the Kurds and the Turks. In Ankara, the capital of Turkey, we find ourselves in another civil war, albeit less violent, more subdued. It pits two opposing groups, two different versions of Turkish modernity. Proponents of secularism up against Muslim conservatives. On the one side, you have supporters of Ataturk, the father of secularism, who abolished the caliphate and banned the hijab at university. And on the other, supporters of Erdogan, the man who re-established a place for Islam in daily life and declared abortion a crime. Let's first begin with the secularists. Anil is a bassist in a rock band and is about to get a rather surprising tattoo. I have many tattoos. I'm just missing the signature of Ataturk. And I have one from a long time ago. Having a tattoo at this moment requires political courage because we are currently in a tense period. For me, Ataturk is a very special person. I want to wear something on my body that symbolizes him in order to never forget. So far, nobody has gotten tattooed with the name of Prime Minister Erdogan. Well, at least I've never done it. The youth, to the rescue of Ataturk? Not as strange as you might think. After all, young people have always been at the heart of Ataturk's policies. And you needn't look any further than the mausoleum devoted to him. In 2011, 4 million Turks came to honor the father of the nation, a million more than the previous year. So why is he all the craze? You can ask anyone in Turkey, and everyone will say they are pro-Ataturk, but the values he defended are under threat. For the AKP, religion is a way to control the people and to indoctrinate the country and to Islamize society, to confine women to the home. These young people came out of the woodwork the day they felt under threat. And so when the AKP put a stop to the day of commemoration traditionally dedicated to the youth by Ataturk, they took to the streets. All that the AKP wants to do is to overthrow the Republic and replace it with an Islamic state. We will never bow down to Sharia law. Within a year, nearly 600 students were arrested by the AKP government, simply because they had expressed themselves democratically. In Ankara, there's a place where this tension crystallizes, at the university, where the students are celebrating the end of the year. What are you looking for? I'm checking to see if there is any alcohol. We want to avoid excessive consumption of alcohol on campus. On the one hand, they hunt down alcohol. Yet they close their eyes when it comes to veiled students, even though wearing headscarves in the universities is still forbidden by the Constitution. Times are definitely changing in Turkey. We've been able to wear it to school for about a year now without any problem. Before, they tried to prevent us from entering through the main door or inside the classroom. But now we can attend all classes, in lecture halls, in labs, everywhere. For us, the veil is absolutely not a political symbol. It does not even come to mind. We wear the veil because of our beliefs. Now the situation has calmed down. We are free to be ourselves, and we are happier that way. An angry teacher lashes out at female students. Our religion also requires your face to be hidden and to wear long skirts. Look, I can see the shape of your legs, which is a sin. Even your hands, we should not see them. From there, it is not a sin. We do what we can. Yes, but you should wear something else. You too. We also see your feet.
My devotion is evolving little by little. First I started by covering my head, and then I will cover my leg. It will come gradually. There you're committing a sin. But where do freedoms end, and where do they begin? When can a woman like me can no longer teach here? When will boys and girls no longer be able to study in the same classroom? This university is ranked among the top 100 in the world. All courses are conducted in English, and the students that are veiled still represent a tiny minority. But if this trend continues, the determination shown by these secular students suggests that there are risks involved when it comes to keeping the peace on campuses. On the university's stadium bleachers, the word Devrim, revolution, has never been erased since the events of 1968. In the evening, the festival ends the way it began, with a giant concert given by Cheval Chand, an activist singer. Is Erdogan a danger to Republican and secular values? Possibly. Even the military who came before him, and who repeatedly exercised power by force, were anything but democratic. In the name of Ataturk and the fight against communism or against Islam, the Turkish military systematically violated human rights. This is their trial, which opens today at the courthouse in Ankara, on the dock General Evren. He led the country between 1980 and 1989. He was responsible for 650,000 arrests and more than 100 executions. These are the faces of his victims: trade unionists, communists, Kurds, Islamists, artists. The photos you see here are those of our friends who disappeared in custody. At least if their remains had been returned to the families, even that might have helped calm things down a little. I was imprisoned for 8 years without a trial. I was tortured with electricity, rope, cigarettes. I still have scars everywhere. Among the plaintiffs, a woman of 104 years who came specially from Istanbul by ambulance. She swore she would not die until they returned the body of her son, Jamil, a left-wing activist arrested the day after the coup d'etat of General Evren. She hasn't seen her son in over 30 years.
Cemil, kırmayın, ölürsün.
And with the trial of the former military dictatorship welcomed by the European Union, Erdogan has hit two birds with one stone. First, he honed in on his image as a Democrat. Then he called on the urgent need to change the constitution, drafted in 1982 by the very man he is now judging, General Evren. The debate that has begun in Parliament is heated. The undertaking of this constitutional reform is immense and delicate. The pro-Kurdish parliamentary group demands respect for its identity. For the Kemalists, solid guarantees for secularism. As for Erdogan, he wants a strong and stable presidential system, one which would ensure him a place in power as long as possible. Istanbul, the last stop on this trip. While Istanbul is the capital of Turkey, it is so far away from the thriving Turkish heartland that has profited from Erdogan's business initiatives. Istanbul, where East meets West. You have Asia on one side of the Bosporus and Europe on the other side, making Istanbul the veritable crossroads between Europe and Asia. Just like these shuttles from another era that run between the giant freighters to connect the two banks of the Bosporus. And it's not a coincidence that some really successful series have been shot in Istanbul, Turkey's cosmopolitan center, and have overtaken Brazilian telenovelas in popularity. The current series built on the Chronicles of Misfortune is entitled Gone with the Times. This is not very original, but the formula works. Here's the proof. We've just shot the 75th episode of this series. This TV drama tells the story of several Turkish women from the 1960s onward. Ayşe is the heroine of the series. The name of her character is Cemile, and it profiles a modern woman. Cemile has four children, who she's raised by herself since her husband left her for someone else. She endured major financial difficulties. And now she must start over again and find a job. This is the story of a determined and courageous Turkish woman. These women wear short dresses, they work and live their lives. Stories of women filmed by a woman, Zeynep, and they have developed a huge following. Each week, 30 million Turks tune in. For a long time, Turkey was served a hearty helping of French and American culture. But today, we tell our own stories, and they've become big sellers worldwide. The Arab world, the Balkans, and the Caucasus are the best customers of these series. For the people of the Middle East and the Arab Muslim world, Turkey is a Muslim country, but also secular. Through these series, they are shown a lifestyle that is both Muslim and European. How we dress, how we interact with each other, including among family. For those Muslim women in the Middle East, these dramas have become a window into our lifestyle. Turkey has exported more than 100 series like these. The last great production to date of Turkey's main public channel is called Once Upon a Time, The Ottomans, a movie that glorifies the destiny of Sultan Mehmed III and nostalgia for the empire. Despite some disenchantment, Europe is still well regarded. Among minorities, it even blows a little air of freedom into the storyline, something unusual in Turkey. In Istanbul, an AKP municipality since 1994, gay pride sweeps through the capital every year. In the oldest gay bar in the city, Nedim, a former English teacher turned drag queen, still laughs about the long journey in getting there.
This is Sekuren. He was the most famous singer in Turkey. He was wearing short skirt and he was saying, this is a gladiator costume. It was funny. He couldn't say that time that he was gay. Then somebody asked her, Sekuren, why are you wearing this clothes? He was saying, I am a macho man, but this is my show costume. My grandfather loved him very much, and he was drinking rock and saying, oh, Sekuren, I love you. But when I was walking, he was shouting, don't walk like a girl, don't walk like, don't behave like a girl. You, oh my God, what are we going to do with you?
Michelle is an activist in the LGBT section. Lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender of Istanbul, a very active international movement in Turkey. Since Turkey has gone through the member process, the European Union has noted the democratic progress Turkey is making, and it strengthens us as gays and lesbians. The EU has got to bring Turkey in as a member, especially for us, who are still being discriminated against. Please bring us into Europe. The argument is original and rarely heard. A clue without a doubt showing Turkish society is very different from what it used to be. Of course, Turkey is a Muslim country, but it is run like a democracy. It is not governed by Sharia law. In this Muslim country, a transsexual can have a beer in a gay bar without any problems. You Europeans and your media, stop comparing Turkey to Iran. Turkey is not Iran, and Erdogan is not Ahmadinejad. That is a certainty, but still. When students demonstrate and protest against the arbitrary arrest of 300 of them, when the master pianist, Fazıl Say, is dragged into court for blasphemy, or when the government removes subsidies to public theaters, a source of constant contention. What should we conclude from that? Cenk Erkal is one of the most engaged actors in the country. Is it really a coincidence that he plays Brecht in this city's theater? Brecht, who castigated the rise of fascism and authoritarianism in Germany in the 1930s?
Kesinlikle eleştiriye tahammülü yok.
Erdogan does not tolerate any criticism. The first thing he did when he became prime minister was to sue a political cartoonist who caricatured him as a cat. You wouldn't see that anywhere else. He cannot even tolerate an innocent caricature. On the one hand, you have a conservative Islamist government, and on the other, the values of a secular republic. The two are incompatible. Over time, the government has executed a power grab, and today it has put its fingerprints on justice, education, the presidency, and the army. And now it's even taking on culture. Its aim is to impose a reactionary culture.